itself so okay. that I can eat food. Recording is on.
Sounds good. While you're muted, can I go ahead and do like an introduction to OpenRocket?
E.
Okay. Ooh. All right, everyone. So this workshop is going to be an introduction to OpenRocket. This is basically a way of simulating how your rocket flies and determining what happens and if it's successful or if it crashes and burns. Let's go to my files. First you'll need this OpenRocket jar file. That's what opens this window. And you will also need this PNL Callisto work file, which is in the PSAS Rocket Certs Slack channel. It should be pinned. If not, then contact me, Gabe, and I'll make sure that it's visible and available to people.
Gabe?
Yes?
Where do we get those? Where do we get the OpenRocket file?
You can also look for them online.
Okay.
Have you tried just looking it up, Joe? Yeah. And later on, we'll also be using these two Aerotech files. Those are basically files for the rocket motors that we're using, but we'll get to that when we get there. So let's go ahead and... No, I want to... I want to open that. So once you open the file, this is pretty much what it gives you from the get-go. I'm going to move this over here. So this is a representation of the Callisto kit that you are building. And in this case, I guess the standard, or I guess what you should be getting when you open this file is something like this without the motor, but you can add your motors later on. If you click on any of the exterior things, it'll show up in this side menu here, and you can edit, you can go in and like edit the mass of your components. So I'll go through with just like a rundown of like what all of these are, and then also kind of just to give an idea of like, I guess, connecting the dots between what we've been building in the assembly workshops and what is going on here. So the nose cone's pretty self-explanatory. That's the fancy cone shape at the top of your rocket. A lot of the settings, like the component materials, are already preset. So this is the correct material. This is the correct length and diameter and all of that. The only override that you would need to do is if you add something additional to your rocket. And even then, I would recommend that you just add a mass component. Your fins, your motor mount tube, your piston. So one of the things you can do with something like your piston is you can move its position around. So this is normally how the rocket is, shown off in like simulations, but realistically you're going to have your piston more like here on your rocket. And the reason is because Even though you're sanding down your wooden piston a lot, so it slides really easily in this tube, you still want to make sure that this piston leaves your airframe once your recovery system deploys. So if you want a more realistic representation of your rocket when doing simulations, it's a good idea to move your piston and your parachute up towards your nose cone. I'll do that with the parachute as well. And they're added on. So there's a couple of little like things in the piston, and those are components that are attached or in like combined with that specific part. I'm just going to move the, there it is. So they don't have to be perfect per se, because you are going to have a little bit of like parachute cord realistically between these. But if you can get, as long as these two stay pretty close together, then it'll be fine. You just don't want your parachute behind your piston, because then your rocket will not have a good time. So you've got your launch lugs. So this little strip here is an added in mass component for things like epoxy paint and like things like sticker decals. You shouldn't have to worry too terribly much about its mass, but if you want this to be really as accurate as you can, or like as you can make it, then it would be a good thing to add. And then you've got your rings on your motor mount tube. So one of the nice things that OpenRocket does is it provides you with your stability, your center of gravity, which is the blue and white circle, and the center of pressure, which is the red, or it looks red. I don't know if it's red or orange. It's something like that. And it'll also tell you the like total mass of your rocket with no motor. You can also add a motor and see how the mass changes. You can, like in the bottom corner when you add motors, so let's add a motor into here, you can see about how high your rocket's going to go based off of these values and its mass. So one of the things you can do is play around with this to see, like you can move your center of gravity around to see how that affects apogee and your velocity and your acceleration. So that's pretty straightforward with that. So that was under rocket design. It would also be a good idea if you're using a personal safety alarm to include that in a mass component. You could probably just add it to your epoxy paint miscellaneous area. Those don't weigh very much, but they are, that is something that I would recommend having on your rocket when you're doing simulations. It might even be worth putting it near your piston, because I've been recommending to folks who are going with the option of using a like personal safety alarm or some type of noise making device to put it up by your piston. So if you can add that to your piston as an additional mass component, then that would work just fine. Otherwise, you can just do a little line representing a mass component like this, and then move it around as you need it. So, excuse me. Under motors and configuration, this is where you get to mess around with what kinds of motors you want to use. So when you do a new configuration and then either double click on this none category under like the 38 millimeter motor mount tube column, or say select motor, this pops up. This is a list of all the possible motors that Aerotech in this case, will offer. For a level one, we are looking at an H motor. So you can narrow down your searches to make your life easier. And the motors that we have been, or the motors that we used for level ones last year, were H219s and H283s. They're very similar motors, slightly different thrust curves. And those are, let's go over here. That's where these two files come in handy. I've been informed that I forgot to put these into the Slack channel, so I can for sure add those. I've also heard that these might be out of date, so it would be just as reasonable to just look up H283 motor and go find the thrust curve for a good place that I've found is thrustcurve.org. They typically have a .eng file that you can download. They might have a slightly different cert designation, but they're pretty much the same thing. Let's go back all the way to minimize that. There we go. So you'll need to use those and to insert your files. That's under edit. So it's to add those files to OpenRocket, you go to edit and preferences, and then you have to include them in these user-defined thrust curves. So you just have to copy the, like, where those files are being stored, and then you will have to restart your OpenRocket to get it to show up in the system. So that's what I did with these two motors. I guess I don't need that, so I'll just... Okay, I guess it won't let me remove it. That's fine. Once you have these, you can, like... I mean, that's really all that you need. You don't have to do any, like, specific edits or anything with that. It should fit just like this in the, in your rocket. If you're doing a... if you're doing a different type of recovery system, this might come in handy, but for level ones, you don't have to worry about it because these motors use ejection charges. Excuse me. I had coffee this morning and it's my throat's deciding that it's just not enjoying it. So we will talk more in detail about the ejection charges and how to set up the motors in your rockets when we get closer to launch day. But really all you need to know at this time is that the motors come with a little black powder charge that pushes the piston out of the airframe. So once you have your motors into this table, then you can go to flight simulations. So this is where you can run simulations and see what happens to your rocket. So let's edit this simulation. So when it comes up, there, like, when you're editing or doing a new simulation, this is the window that pops up. It's basically, these are pretty standard. These are like the default settings. I would recommend subbing in your Latin longitude for the Brothers launch site, which is a pretty quick Google search. But it's also good to figure out. I think from what I recall, 60 inches is a little generous for the length of the launch rail, but that's about. That shouldn't be too big of an issue for the type of simulation that we're running. You're definitely welcome to mess around with wind speeds and like, and temperatures as well. You can just uncheck that and mess around with temperature. The launch angle, it, for the most part, will be straight up. There might be some deviation because of uneven terrain, so you can mess around with, like, what that angle is.
Can I interject a bit?
Yes.
For launch rail length, and really for wind, you probably want to, like, get the actual numbers and double check it on a laptop, like the day of the launch, just to make super sure. Because if something does go wrong, it'll be like the instant it leaves the rail. At least with stability.
Yeah. Yeah, this is definitely something that it's good to get familiar with before you go out to the launch site, and then definitely make sure you have a full computer battery so you can do a couple of simulations out there as well. What's nice about this is that you don't need an internet connection. You just need a phone battery, or not a phone battery, a computer battery. Although you do want to make sure that all of the files you need are on your computer before you head out.
Hey, Gabe.
Hey.
Hey, I wonder if, I actually don't know how important it is, but if altitude of the launch site for Brothers is important, because it's about 3,000 something feet. I'm not sure what that influences in this calculation, but might be worth considering.
Yeah, this is, like, the launch site stuff is definitely information that you can find readily online. And so what you see on the screen right now is just the default information that it spits out at you. So you're more than welcome to adjust these. But yeah, when you're doing launch site specific things, you should definitely look up lat, longitude, and altitude as well. Because you do want to make this as realistic as possible. You can also make sure you have a motor selected. Really, that's about it. So then you simulate it, and then you can... So I've already run this simulation before, so it wasn't very long. It didn't take very long to actually do it. In my experience, it doesn't take very long for the simulation to run, but I've had some instances where it takes a little bit longer for it to do things. You can add, like, different things to put onto your y-axis. So say you wanted to look at, what's something we should look at? Altitude, vertical velocity. Let's look at vertical orientation, just because we can. Excuse me. So if you're looking for specific information in these simulations, you can adjust these however you see fit. Really, the ones that we're looking at are like altitude, your velocities and accelerations. You can also determine, or you can also show on the plot that we'll see in a moment, what things you specifically want to see. So that's what this flight event stuff is. So it will show things like when the motor burns out, when the rocket should reach apogee, when the recovery system deploys, all of that. So when we go to the plot, this is what shows up. And at first, it looks a bit chaotic. Don't worry, that's a, like, fairly normal thing, especially if you have, like, a bunch of different things being plotted at the same time. So ideally, a good words exist. What am I trying to say? So going to this, so we see that even though this simulation 2 ran, it did have a little bit of an error, and that was saying that, hey, your recovery system is deploying at, like, a really high speed. So if we take a look at that, you can, like, with this, you can figure out, like, what's going on with any errors that, won't let me do that, with any errors that potentially come up. If you change your motor or change something about your rocket, you'll have to run these simulations again. Yeah, so you can also zoom in on specific areas. It's kind of a butt to do sometimes, but Joe, do you have any advice about these plots and simulations?
It'd be good to show people how to zoom in and out on them.
Use the mouse wheel. Aha. So you
can... Oh, I didn't realize you could use the mouse wheel, actually.
Yeah, so down at the bottom, you can, like, manually press the buttons. So it's hard to see, but this button will zoom in, this button will zoom out, kind of, and then the middle button will restore the original view. And then if you are using a mouse with a track wheel, you can use the track wheel to zoom in as well. That's what I'm doing with that. So if your flight looks like, if your altitude looks kind of like this and it looks like a nice, pretty type of thing, then that's a pretty good sign. Usually something like this is a fairly successful launch. It's a mild concern that your recovery system's deploying at a high speed, but it's not the end of the world. let's see what we can do to mess up the simulation.
One thing to point out is the stability margin calibers.
Mm-hmm.
Just because, like, that you can kind of only get from OpenRocket. I mean, they might also say it in the kit. I'm not sure. But the kit will tell you where your center of pressure is. But mm-hmm. the RSOs will want you to, like, demonstrate that you know what your stability margin caliber is.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll want it to be above one.
Yeah. Like, what I have it set at right now is not ideal, but it's more than one, so it is acceptable. So I was just messing around with the mass of the nose cone. So you'll see that in my simulations, it says, whoa, something's not right. What did you do? So let's take a look at that. And if you have all of your setting, go ahead.
One thing to note, the stability calibers it quotes in that little design window are just taken at a single altitude and velocity, so it's somewhere in the preferences of OpenRocket, but I think it's usually at sea level and at some, like, medium low Mach number. So it's not actually telling you what your minimum stability caliber is between launch and burnout.
Mm-hmm. Is that something that you can see in, like, the simulation data?
Yes, that's what I was getting at. Is you kind of just have to plot it.
Yeah.
So if you just select stability margin caliber, and then I also like to check the box that shows where the launch rod clearance occurs.
Mm.
If you just hit S, it should take you to it.
Speed of sound, simulation. Aha, there it is. Okay, let's add those and see what it does.
Yeah, and it'll only display the stability once you're off the launch rail. It's just kind of nice to have that event in there so you can, like, line it up with other things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So messing around with, that's a good point. Thank you for adding that. messing around with the mass of the nose cone, you can definitely see how that changed where, like, how high the rocket will go, like where its apogee is. You can also see that it's adjusted, or like it's messed with some of the other stuff as well, but the main thing it messed with was its altitude. Yeah. So definitely play around with it. There's lots of things you can mess with in these. I don't remember what this was. It was 2.5. I don't remember what this was. It was probably at zero. So, yeah. Are there any questions from people who are hanging out with us today about this? Anything I can clarify at all?
Not yet, but it's nice to see this. Thank you for doing this.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. One of the things when you're like out at the launch site, this is definitely a good thing to show the person who's going to be witnessing your launch, whether that is an RSO or a TAP member or whoever is basically committing to watching your rocket. This is good stuff to show because it also kind of tells them that you've done more than just built your rocket. You've also made sure that that you're not intentionally trying to turn your rocket into a missile. And this information, like center of gravity, stability, stuff like that, is also information that they will ask for when you're filling out paperwork. So that's also good information to have. And like, from what I recall, stability can be calculated by hand. It's just kind of a pain in the ass to do sometimes. But if you are someone who likes doing math, you are welcome to calculate your stability if you so desire. Any lingering, burning questions? Here's where I do the instructor thing and I just wait an uncomfortable amount of time for people to talk about something.
What's your favorite color of rocket?
Oh, I mean, I think as long as it's obnoxious, like that's the peak aesthetic. I don't really know how to answer that because I don't know if you saw Emilio's rocket last year, but it was like construction orange, like neon orange with like a dark blue spiral. And it was an eyesore to look at, but it was also very beautifully done. I don't know. I mean, I kind of like the like orange and like orange and blue, I guess. What about you?
I mean, I think the answer that as long as it's obnoxious is a pretty good answer.
You can't copy the answer, though.
I don't know. I mean, I think I'm planning on like orange with green diamonds, or maybe like turquoise diamonds.
Nice.
Just because I have neon orange and neon green paint.
Yes.
I imagine the highest contrasting colors you can have with the desert terrain is going to make it easier to find.
Yeah.
I mean, if you paint your rocket like fire engine red, that's also really noticeable.
True.
During NXRS last year, I think it was a university team. I don't remember. It was a level 3 equivalent rocket that was like basically fire engine red, and they did a beautiful nosedive into the ground, but you could still see where it was because the fin can was sticking out of the ground and it was bright red and it stuck out like a sore thumb in the shrubbery.
Mm-hmm. And by the way, Brothers is at about 4,600 feet and has a Wikipedia page, surprisingly.
Uh-huh. The crossroads in the middle of nowhere has a wiki.
You should check out the page. It's a little bit funny.
Do you know the coordinates of it?
Does it say on here?
Somewhere east.
Ooh.
So yes. Like 30 something lat or something like that.
I actually have my notes up for it. It's 43.4 degrees latitude, minus 120 degrees longitude. Let's check if that's actually correct.
It's 43 degrees, 48 minutes, 49 seconds north, 120, 36 minutes, 12 seconds west. So I don't know if you need a decimal, but...
I mean,
do you need the exact square foot of the gas station?
Yeah.
Yes.
Maybe I can put it in chat here if I can remember how to do that. Here we go. Wait. Okay, it is in the chat.
There it is.
Oh, why is it an elevation of 4,639 feet? Interesting.
Huh. Let's throw those into here. And negative 120.
Make sure it's not double negative. Yeah, there you go.
It's positive 120 now. Oh, it just rounded up to 121.
Do you know what it uses the coordinates for? I mean, elevation, I can imagine, but I kind of wonder what.
There might be some, what do you call it, Coriolis effects added in. I mean, they're going to be completely negligible.
Yeah. Like,
okay, I did like a whole project on this. trying to see Coriolis effects for projectiles on Earth is really, really difficult.
Yeah. I guess the other thing I will add is if you feel like exporting your data for some reason, that would be under the Edit Simulation tab. That's also... Actually, it's under plot export, but you can get there through edit simulation. You just do simulate and plot, and then in this window before you go down to plot, there's a tab for export data, and you can export to your heart's content. But yeah. Look at how pretty that is. This is basically what you want your... Like, the recovery deployment is a little non-ideal, but it's not the end of the world. For something like this, there is a way to... I think it's under motors?
I mean, you could tune it with ballast, right?
You could. Aha. So under motors and configuration, if you go to recovery, you can delay the, you can do kind of like a manual delay, which would be the equivalent of in person with your motor. So I guess for context, when you have your physical motor, with how this simulation looks, you won't let me do that. Okay, I'm just going to do this. Bloop. This delay is not entirely ideal. Like, it'll definitely work, but you already, this is non-ideal because you're deploying a parachute at a faster than desirable speed. And if you do, if your recovery system is too late, then you can, I think the best case scenario is that your rocket gets tangled into your parachute. The worst case scenario is that you could potentially just shred your rocket. But you want this recovery deployment to happen closer to apogee. So with the physical motor, because it's the, oh man, I'm gonna forget what the material is. Like, Adam, help.
ammonium perchlorate and aluminum something.
Yeah. The rocket fuel. like, you can tinker with the, like, with this this value of when your recovery system deploys. And the way that's done is when you're out on the launch site or out at the launch site, most of the people out there have these tools, but you basically drill out a little bit of the solid fuel from the motor, and that shortens the time that it's that the motor's burning. If you were to simulate that, you would do it under the recovery section, I believe. And you can mess with the you can mess with the settings to get your recovery your recovery deployment closer to apogee. And that's like, if you were to show this to your RSO or TAP member or whoever's witnessing your launch, they'll probably say the same thing, that you should drill out like a second or two of fuel, because that will shorten, that'll help move this recovery deployment closer to apogee.
When you drill out a motor, do you just drill all the way through the center and just make the diameter of the hole slightly larger?
Basically, they have, what's the name of that? The drill bit is, like one of those, like, I'm really bad at names, but it's the one where it's like a metal cup with a bunch of teeth at like the quote rim of the cup, and it makes a hole into whatever you're drilling into.
Like a hole saw?
Hole saw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They use something similar to that. They either use that or they use the I guess what you typically imagine for making a hole in something with the thing that looks like a shovel with a single little prong in the middle.
Oh, a spade bit, or
I think so.
Something like that. I know what you mean. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, like they use one of those two tools, and they have them. more or less calibrated. Like, well, I say more or less when I mean, like, they've, like, through lots of practice and patience, they've calibrated and perfected, like, how much needs to be drilled out of a motor to get rid of this many seconds of burn time. So really, most of the people out there who have been in amateur rocketry for decades, a good number of them have those tools. The person who's been helping us with these level one kits, Dave Armstrong, is definitely a good resource because he has, like, he knows how all of that works and who to get a hold of. And that's one of the people that we'll be interacting with when we're out at the launch site and getting people certified. So. So yeah. I guess some of the other fancy little features of OpenRocket, if you want to see, like, different views of your rocket, you can mess around with some of this.
Fancy.
I know. It's very party. But yeah. That's if that's a thing that helps you with, like, working on this, then cool. I typically just do the side view because it easily displays everything, and it just, to me, makes it more organized. So I guess I can do a simulation with the other motor. I'm too lazy to actually put in all of the a zero length launch. That's fine. Let's do that. Any other fancy things? I don't think so. So this is just with a different motor. Let's keep all of that. And that's interesting.
Oh. that looks like something that went unstable before Apogee.
Yep. So it's hard
not unstable.
Did it tumble?
Just something that experienced wind. So what we should do is we should also plot either the angle of attack or the vertical orientation. We might want to get rid of some things like vertical velocity and acceleration because they're going to just mess up our axes.
Do that. Do we want both angle of attack and vertical orientation?
Yeah, sure, why not?
All right, let's see what this does. So yellow, for context, is stability margin calipers. It's just hard to see down here. So the blue is the angle of attack, and green is vertical orientation.
Yeah, so that actually looks sane.
It didn't look absolutely chaotic.
Because if you look at Apogee, that's when our angle of attack... Oh, no.
Go back. There we go.
Yeah, it gets close to 180, so we're just flying sideways.
Mm. Yeah.
And our orientation starts to point down.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why the stability went crazy.
Ah. Yeah, with things like angle of attack and vertical orientation, it's you should definitely watch out for like what all you're plotting at the same time, because like you saw with the first take of this simulation, the stability margin was like really wild up over here. But then when we looked at what else was going on with the orientation of the rocket, then you could see that it was actually not as chaotically unstable as it appeared. And it was just because it was basically because the rocket had reached apogee and was flipping over to come back down, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And for the edification of anyone who might be watching this in the future, angle of attack is just where the air is flowing relative to your airframe. So if the air is flowing straight from the nose to fins, then that's zero angle of attack. And if your air is flowing sideways over the rocket, that's 90 degrees angle of attack. And if you're flying tail first, then that's 180 degrees.
Yeah, if someone manages to fly their rocket tail first for their L1, I would be very surprised. And you will get a stern talking to from the launch control officer. So.
Right.
Yeah, I guess to like ease concerns, there is really only one correct way to put your motor into your rocket, because the end of the motor has this like larger diameter thing that that is basically held in place by the motor retainer that you all are putting on your kits. So basically, if it doesn't fit into the motor mount tube, then you're putting it in the wrong way. but yeah, so what's some other stuff to look at? I think that's really about it. That's also, so you can also tinker with ignition things, yeah, you can mess around with all kinds of things in here. It won't let me delete this. Ah, I had to do that. That's obnoxious. But yeah, that's pretty much like all of the fun stuff with OpenRocket. When you're building your So when you're building your like level 3 equivalent rocket, then you can do stuff like this where so this is just the PSAS rocket for reference, but it's basically a level 3 equivalent body. So when you're building your level 3, you can basically like for the most part, like really any like, well, you can find pretty much any rocket kit online. There's definitely files for rocket kits. If you're building your airframe on your own, then that's where all of these like new component sections come in, and you can build all of this stuff and create something that looks like this. So, and there's the motor. So yeah, I guess the only other thing, if you're doing, like if you're making your own motor, which you shouldn't be doing if you're doing a level one, but if you're tinkering around with like motor like solid fuel compositions for NXRS, which is the research launch that OROC hosts every year, then to put something into OpenRocket, you would need to make your own thrust curve for it, so it can have like that information to work with. But I certainly hope none of you are making your own motors for a level one. You should be using the motors that you paid for.
I mean, that's better than making your own motor for an L3.
True. So the Fire Engine Red rocket at NXRS was an experimental O motor, N motor or O motor. I don't remember which. But the what happened to it? Basically, the motor wasn't secured inside the rocket, so it ignited slash blew up on the launch pad, and the force from that is what made the airframe of the rocket fly. So yeah. Are there any other concerns about how to open rocket? Oh yeah, you can also rotate this if you're feeling that. That's kind of obnoxious that they don't, like, you can't rotate it like how you would with the other views. You have to do it there, but... Mm.
This was a good intro. I missed the beginning, so I'll watch the recording. But yeah. It seems really cool.
Yeah. And we'll definitely address this again when we get closer to a launch day. And yeah, we'll kind of do like a summary recap of here's OpenRocket. Let's do a simulation of your kit and make sure that it doesn't explode or go flying off somewhere into someone's van. So cool. I will make sure that I'll switch it back here so it's not like infinite Jitsi, but yeah, I'll make sure that the files for the motors, these two, are in Slack under PSAS rocket certs. And if any of you have questions about this recording or about any of the files or how to use OpenRocket, just send me a message and I can help you figure it out.
So. But Gabe, what if we wanted to fly different motors? Where would we find the .eng files for those?
Well, first you would have to figure out what kind of motor you intend to fly. And once you know that information, Google is your friend. So you can go to thrust. A good spot to find motors is thrustcurve.org, and you can search for really any type of motor. The ones that we're using are Aerotech motors, and you can honestly just leave it at that and it will show you all of the motors that Aerotech uses. You do want to make sure that your motor is the same, is fit for the diameter of your rocket, which is a 38 millimeter. As long as you have that and as long as it's an H motor, then they shouldn't cause a scene about it. The main thing is just making sure that your motor doesn't end up just destroying someone's property.
Do you know, for the smaller motors, do they keep with the convention that the size is the outer diameter of the motor casing?
I believe so, yeah.
Cool.
I actually have a couple of motors around here somewhere from last year. But from what I recall, it's the outer diameter of the motor casing, and your motor mount tube is... how much bigger? Not much bigger than the motors. There's like a couple millimeters of room on each side. I think it's like a centimeter at most bigger. At most. It's smaller than that, but it's something. It's probably like, I don't remember how big the motor mount tube is relative to the motors, but I'm sure if you just measured the diameter of it, you could figure it out. But yeah. Yeah, as far as I recall, the diameter that's listed on motor types is the outer diameter of the motor. And your motor mount tube is designed to fit that type of, so it's like it's slightly bigger than the motor, but yeah. Oh yeah, fun fact about these Callisto kits, you can use it for your level 2 certification, because there are I and J motors, I think. For sure, I motors, but some J motors, I believe, that are 38 millimeter. So you can just adjust that, and voila. Look at all of those I motors. Now I'm curious, do they have J motors as a 38? Aha, they do. So yeah, thrust curve is a really good spot to look for motors if you're planning on using a specific kind of motor. I would recommend this more for like level 2 and level 3. For level 1, we're pretty much set on the type of H motor that we're using. If you wanted to use a different kind of motor, there's a mild price difference between these. And you would have to talk to Sun River, like to that store, to see if you can. Well, you'd have to talk to your RSO, and you would have to reach out to Sun River, which is the store that, it's not, the store isn't called Sun River. I don't know the actual name of the store. But Sun River Bob is the one who has been selling the motor or the kits to us. And he's also handling the motors that we are going to use. So if you are wanting to use a different motor, then you'd want to reach out to him. So. But it kind of comes down to what your RSO says. Your RSO will say, like, will ask you what motor you're intending to use, and if they think that that's not a safe option for a level 1, then they will tell you. So,
oh, interesting. I found another ORK that's different from the one you gave me.
like a rocket file or a motor?
Yeah.
Huh.
Actually, could Could you resend me the well, actually, this is why I was asking, where do I download it from? Because there's different sites that offer OpenRocket files for the Callisto kit, and they disagree with each other. I just want, like, the blank reference.
I went to... It looks like I went to Rocket Reviews.
Yeah, because when I hit that download link, it just gave me, like, a 404 error.
Huh.
Okay, interesting.
I guess I'll add this link as well, because this looks like this looks pretty familiar. You can actually download this entire list. But if I just... Yeah, so if you just look up, like, Callisto, you want the one that is shared in... That's not what I wanted to do. In Slack is this one, the 38 millimeter redline Ellis. Let's see what the difference is between those. Let's close that. Gross. Okay, let me move that real quick. And you get to see what's in my downloads folder. So the difference with this one is that they give you a single launch lug versus two launch lugs. So I would recommend getting the one that has the two launch lugs, which is the Redline Ellis. The one that has Redline Ellis in the name.
Mm-hmm.
Oh god, there it is. Yeah. And definitely make sure that it's the 38 millimeter, because otherwise OpenRocket will yell at you for having a... for having a rocket that doesn't fit the motor you're trying to use. Yeah. I think I ended up downloading this entire list somehow, because that's basically
right.
This zip file. I don't remember where I downloaded it, though. Yeah, so that's a thing.
The source of truth is an obnoxious problem in engineering.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, if you're thinking of using a different rocket for your level two, or if you're planning to use a kit for your level three, you can definitely look around at all of the different files. That took me way too long to figure out. I'll share this in Slack. I'll actually do that right now. Boop. Does my computer do that? Oop. So there's that. I will share this. Layer of that, layer of that. Yeah, a lot of the stuff, a lot of the stuff you can find fairly easily with a Google search. Sometimes it's a pain in the butt to find, especially since, like what Joe said, there's multiple flavors of the same rocket. But yeah. I think I'll go ahead and end the recording there.